Good morning.
Good morning.
How is everybody?
Great.
I know that echoing is a nuisance, but just think of it this way. Anybody here sing in the shower? Yeah, that's what it's like. That's what. Good morning, and welcome to the Congregational Church of Eastford. Good morning, for whatever time it is that you watch this video. Hello to the video people out there. We love you. And love to have you with us, but you're not. And so we're hoping that you're blessed right where you are. We are together here, and we are gathered in the name of Jesus, and there's power in those words, because he promised that when two or more are gathered in his name, he would be in their midst. And we get to worship. By the way, I'm always trying to kind of cipher out how that works, because I know he's seated at the right hand of the Father. And the only way it makes sense in my mind is that he is able to warp the heavenlies right down into this space. So we are in the presence of the living God this morning, which is a place of awe and reverence. A couple of announcements. I'm going to begin by asking Sue to come up, and she has something to share about sports camp.
Hi.
It's on.
Good morning. Happy 4th of July. I've got red, white, and blue. I would like to say it's nice to be back with you. I've been gone for two Sundays, and I feel like I was away for forever. But we're still geared up for sports camp. We have 145 children registered. Woo! And we have 57 volunteers, which is really awesome too. So I am in need of some tents. 10 by 20s or a 20 by 20. If anybody has them, if you could speak to me, if you'd be willing to leave it for a week with us, we would appreciate it. So if you just see me after the service, then I will know I have something. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Sue. And much to pray about this month, because we kind of concentrate our big summer outreach into that one week. The 22nd of July is a Saturday, and we have the frog jump, and then the 24th to the 28th, Monday through Friday, is our sports camp. The frog jump is going to be at Crystal Pond Park, so spread that news around. And because we're in a different place, we do know that Yankees do not like change. And so if you've had the same venue for like 10 decades or something, when you move, there'll be some challenges. And so if you can be praying about that, then we'll get that right up there. And also there is, I think, maybe a little additional need for some volunteer help in a couple of areas. And just watch your email about that. But like, for instance, we'll be parking on that ball field up top and running a shuttle bus down to the lakefront area there. And so we need some people up there greeting visitors and telling them, no, that driving down the hill is not for you. Kind of stuff, okay? So special people to be welcoming and also telling them no, okay? So maybe that's you, pray about that. But we're excited about this because we gather together a lot of people, and in both of those venues get to tell them about Jesus, and we get to make acquaintances that can lead to all kinds of great stuff as responsive as relationships with people who are far from God. We make those relationships, and then he uses them to draw people to himself. So I'm excited about that. And of course, this is all later this month, so be in prayer about that. We're here to worship him this morning, don't worry. And it's so good to be in the same space together and in his presence. And I would just offer to you some words here that I should have opened my Bible to in a second. Anybody else a little behind the power curve this morning? Good. Thank you for the encouragement. Why don't you raise your hand?
What? We didn't hear you.
What did you say?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Anybody else what?
A little behind the power curve this morning.
Oh, okay.
Okay, I just learned the lesson. Okay.
You could ask that again now.
Psalm 100 says, make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God, and is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Well, Father in heaven, you are a good, good Father. And we just now, this morning, are about to stand and sing in your presence and in your steadfast love that has endured for the generations from the time that song was written probably 3,000 years ago until this hour. And so it is a privilege to be before you this morning. Would you do as you do, which is to flood this place with a knowledge of yourself and inhabit the praises of your people. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Please stand and join us. Praise the Lord.
Good to hear young voices and love in the house of the Lord. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we are so delighted that we can call you Father. And we know it's because we have been adopted as your sons and daughters by the blood of Jesus. We praise you, we honor you, we just lift up your holy name. And Lord, we ask that your name would be held as holy by all. Father in heaven, you are building and establishing a kingdom. You already have a kingdom. Lord, we ask that you might be using us as your agents of Jesus to build your kingdom. We ask, Lord, that it would be your pleasing will to bring your kingdom to earth. You already did when you sent your son Jesus. And we are an outpost of that kingdom, Lord. We ask that it would grow and prosper and flourish as you work in and through your people here and everywhere on earth, Lord. We want to praise you for all the perfections of your character. You're so pure, so holy, so righteous, so powerful. And you're all good all the time. You never change. And you're also a God who is gracious and compassionate and merciful. You are slow to anger. You are abounding in steadfast love. What a wonderful God you are. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your grace. We are overwhelmed by your steadfast love. Thank you for sending your Son, for loving the world so much that you would give up your only son, that he would come and lay down his life for our sins. Thank you, Jesus, for faithfully being obedient to the Father as you willingly laid your body down, as you allowed your blood to be shed, spilled, that we might have new and everlasting life. And in hallelujah, you rose in victory. We praise you. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that even this hour you're seated at the right hand of the Father, and you're making intercession for us. What a picture that is, Lord. You're bringing our names before the Father right now. But Lord, we know that means this time together is going to be richly blessed. And you, we thank you, Holy Spirit, for being obedient when the Father sent you to come and inhabit sinners saved by grace like us. Thank you, Spirit, for inspiring the Word of God that we might have the very words of the living God open before us this morning and available every day. Words that we can embed within our hearts that we might not sin against you. Words that can be a lamp unto our feet and a light for our path to guide our lives. And the words that bring life, salvation. Thank you. Father, we have so many burdens, Lord. We have people in our assembly here who have lost loved ones. We pray for their comfort. We have people in our families that are far from you. We pray, Lord, that you would draw them to yourself. Lord, we have struggles with illnesses. We pray for healing. We have brokenness in relationships, Lord. We pray for love and humility and repentance and forgiveness that might bring reconciliation. Lord, you're God who takes what is broken and makes it whole. So we ask for that, Lord. We ask for those who are captives to the addictions of the mind, the heart, the flesh. We ask for their release from captivity. Father, above all, we ask that you would be made much of by your people, that our lives would be pointing others to you. The name of Jesus would come off our lips often, and you might allow us to proclaim his excellencies into the darkness of a broken and dying world, that the light might come and bring them the love and the peace and the joy and the hope that we have received because you love us and you call us to yourself. Father, we have personal concerns. Would you hear our unspoken prayers in a quiet moment? Father, hear us now as we pray, as our Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever and ever. Amen. Well, amen. Amen. Well, the Congregational Church of Eastford is certainly in a season of change. It's been now a couple of months, but we had that abrupt change where we had to reorganize where we worship, where we hold our Bible studies, how we host ministries like Grief Share and Celebrate Recovery and ACOLO, where our offices are going to be, a season of change. And the Lord's not done with change, right? Because there will then be a season of rebuilding that's upon us right now, and then like new settings and any decisions to be made. And you know what? I think in general, people don't like change. Do you like change?
No.
Okay. Yeah, okay. I'm getting a majority no vote. I mean, some people do like change, and there are people that have that just kind of spirit of nomadic adventure. I know when I was growing up, about every 6 or 8 years, my dad got bored with where we lived, and we just went to some other time zone. And so my whole life was like that. But I know a lot of people are like, change? I said, I don't know. I mean, I spent like years finding a pediatrician I trusted. I trust I'm not leaving. So my kids are gone, right? We don't like change very much, do we? Do we? Let me give you an example of a change you might welcome. Imagine with me a little flight of fantasy that some years ago, you were in the wrong place at the wrong time. and a serious crime was committed, and you had a very close resemblance to a perpetrator who was seen in a shadowy time in the night. And you became a person of interest in that investigation. And you ended up before a police lineup. And the witness says, yeah, that's the guy. That's him. And it was you, and you didn't do it. And you're like horrified, and you get a good lawyer, but the witness testimonies and the fact you didn't have an alibi, and you were in that neighborhood when it happened, and maybe even they figured out a way you might have had a motive for whatever happened, and you get convicted of a crime you did not commit. Those of us that watch those TV crime shows, they often have a plot line like that, right? Where there's some guy in jail, and that investigators discover some new evidence. And they discover that the guy that's in jail, now in this story, that's like you, right? You're in jail, and you've been there for, it's a serious crime. Maybe you've been locked up for, I don't know, 15 years. And then the guards come, and they take you to the warden's office, and you're offered a seat, and the warden says, we have some wonderful news for you. You see, new evidence has come, and maybe DNA evidence, I don't know. But new evidence has come, and it's been discovered that you absolutely did not do this crime. And so your conviction is overturned. You're free to go. Just a little side comment. I don't know if you've heard about this, but there are people that get so accustomed to being in prison after a long time that when they are released, they commit another crime to get back into prison because they know the ropes in prison. And they're so uncomfortable with the change associated with freedom that they reject it and turn back. But that's not my main point. My main point is that if you are wrongly convicted and that conviction is overturned and you come to the truth of that, that can be absolutely delightful news. We're going to look at the book of Acts this morning. We're still in chapter 2. We're still on that day of Pentecost. That place where tens or maybe even hundreds of thousands of pilgrim Jews have gathered in Jerusalem to celebrate a feast, celebrating the first grain harvest of the year and also the giving of the law of Moses. Celebration of God's provision, his physical provision, his spiritual provision. And if you remember the story, it is a very special day because it's when the Father sends the Holy Spirit and it inhabits the followers of Jesus, and the church is given, if you will, the breath of life. And just like what God created Adam, he made him from dust and he was lifeless, and then he breathed life into them. There are pictures in scripture like that, the Spirit of God breathing into the bones in the dry valley in Ezekiel 37, and they come to life. The church comes to life on this day of Pentecost. And of course, what had happened previously is Jesus leaves his throne in heaven, humbles himself, comes like in the form of one of us, takes on the form and behavior of a slave, and is obedient unto death, even death on a cross, where he dies for our sins, after 3 years of powerful ministry of speaking the word in ways that were surprising to many, but true, and doing the miraculous, even raising people from the dead. And at the end of those 3 years, the religious authorities that had discovered that Jesus was teaching stuff that suggested they might be wrong, they didn't like that change, and so they stood against him, and they organized his crucifixion in accordance with God's preset plan and foreknowledge. Jesus is nailed to a cross by people that are threatened or frightened by him. And he dies on a cross for your sins and mine, is buried on the third day, rises again, spends 40 days being seen by his followers and others, literally hundreds of people, for sure knowing that Jesus had risen from the dead. And then after having told his followers, you need to stay in Jerusalem because not many days after this, that promise of the Holy Spirit is going to come. He goes up into heaven and leaves. That's where he is today. He's alive, seated at the right hand of the Father. Well, 9 days after that, the Holy Spirit comes on the day of Pentecost. We've been looking at this for a couple of Sundays. And when the Holy Spirit shows up, it is with powerful manifestations. The wind that is the sound of a mighty rushing wind, like that wind of life, like the breath in Adam's nostrils. And then tongues of fire, the power that brings purity and also the power to serve our great God. And then speaking in languages that the speaker didn't understand, but the audience did, the power to proclaim the good news of Jesus all across the world. for all time until he comes back. Or another crowd goes, like, what's up with that? That's Mike's paraphrase. And then Peter stands up and says, this stuff is not because these people are drunk or something. This is actually the fulfillment of prophecy given by the prophet Joel in the 5th century about the Holy Spirit coming. And then he gets up in their grill, doesn't he? He says to them that this Jesus of Nazareth was a man attested to you by mighty deeds, mighty works, and wonders and signs. And you guys, according to God's definite plan and foreknowledge, with the help of wicked men, and you murdered him. And so this is like a serious, like, uh-oh moment in the lives of these, I would say, faithful, committed, devout Jews that are there because they're being obedient to the word of God. It's like, are you kidding me? And they experience profound change. And that's what we're going to look at this morning. The change in how it happens. Because if you're a follower of Jesus, you had a big change in your life when that happened. How does that work? How does God do it? And we're going to see it on display this morning, and we're going to read some scripture we looked at last week, but we're going to have a fresh perspective. It is Acts chapter 2, beginning in verse 37. I invite you to stand. This is right after Peter has made his case. He says, let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. And we pick up this with this morning's text. Acts chapter 2, verse 37. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, and for your children, and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And with many other words he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. Well, Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. And we know, Lord, that these are words of life and of power that can move us to make changes that we might have resisted before. But by your Spirit, Lord, would you open our hearts to change this morning? That your word might have your way in us. Move our hearts to surrender to you now, Lord, to that end. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Have a seat if you would, please. Okay, so after these guys have been presented with the truth that Jesus really is the Son of God and they killed him, they have now what appears to be a sense of willingness and eagerness, urgency to change. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the people, or the rest of the apostles, I'm sorry, brothers, what shall we do? So they go, okay, we understand now that like the baton has just been handed to us. And now we want to do something because we know we're in trouble and we feel like there's something we ought to do to get out of trouble. By the way, that's an interesting perspective because in God's economy, there's very little you can do to get out of trouble because the things you got that got you into trouble are like beyond like making okay. Does that make sense? Okay? You can't get yourself out of trouble. He has to do it for you. And that's what he did when he sent Jesus to die on the cross, was to die for your sins so that you might be forgiven as an act of mercy and grace, a free gift, not something you earned. But these guys are going, like, what shall we do? What shall we do? I would offer to you that their willingness to change is because the convictions in their hearts that they walked into that assembly with, if you will, the verdicts that they had rendered in their lives are being overturned. The verdict that they had in their heart about Jesus is being overturned. If you know the earlier part of the story, when they were there 7 weeks and a few days earlier, when Jesus had been betrayed and was on trial, and the thing that sealed the deal for his enemies was when he clearly represented that he held himself to be God. They said, well, that's like blasphemy. And the Old Testament's pretty clear. You can't say anything about God that diminishes God. And so if you, like a mere human, claim to be God, you just diminish God, and so you're a blasphemer, and that, in the Old Testament law, is punishable by death. So what they viewed Jesus as was a dangerous criminal that was a blasphemer. And so when the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, brings Jesus out and says, you know, because we've got this custom where I can release a prisoner, what do you want me to do with Jesus? And they are, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. They are as a jury that are voting that Jesus is guilty of a blasphemy crime beyond a reasonable doubt. So they have condemned Jesus in their heart. They have chosen to reject him in their heart. And what they've just been presented with is new evidence. I mean, this Jesus, Peter says, a man attested to you by mighty works, wonders, and signs. He really did all those miracles, and they know it. But the big deal is, after he killed him, he rose from the dead. Think of this for a second, that the resurrection of Jesus Christ vacates, overturns, reverses the verdict of men towards Jesus. I mean, how many people do you know that if you talk to them about Jesus are dismissive of Jesus? Like, what's he got to do with anything? He doesn't matter. Why should I put my trust in Jesus? And they're dismissive, right? Now, that's not quite the same as saying crucify and crucify, but actually it is. It is choosing to render Jesus as something other than he is and somehow inadequate and smaller. It is to render a guilty verdict on Jesus. And Peter has just shown them, because of what Jesus did of the resurrection, and also the fact that Old Testament prophets, Luke cites two references here from the Psalms. But did you hear it said with many other words? He continued to exhort them, saying, yeah, over 350 Old Testament prophecies about Jesus that could only be fulfilled by Jesus to pick from. And I bet he dished a whole lot more to persuade these guys that, guess what? You were wrong about Jesus. You were wrong. How many people like to be told they're wrong? Isn't it a delight? Especially something that you believed in and acted on. Say, hey, bub, you're wrong. How does that go down? Not well, right? But they seem to be convinced. And it's actually, I think, evidence of the ministry and the power of the Holy Spirit in that place and that time, the Word of God and the Holy Spirit can break through the hardest heart and convince you to accept the fact that you're wrong. Wrong about Jesus. But in the middle of this, they also discover there's another verdict that they have rendered, and it's the not guilty verdict that they have rendered in their own lives. I don't have any sin. I'm fine with God. I mean, after all, why were they there? If you said, like, why didn't you go to Jerusalem that day? They said, well, it's kind of a pain in the neck because it's a long walk. If you were from Galilee, 60 miles. And we went there, though, because this is what we do, because we are God's chosen people. And in his word, he made a covenant with us. And in that covenant, he said, I want you to go three times to where I am for worship. In Jesus' time, it's that temple. And I want you to go there in the early spring and remember when I set you free from captivity. In the late spring, that's what they're there for, this Feast of Pentecost. Anyway, oh, by the way, come back in the fall and observe the Day of Atonement, about the need for blood sacrifices for sin. And then the Feast of Weeks, of Tabernacles, Sukkot, to remember that time you were living in tents in the desert. So they're there because God told them to be there. So it's kind of like if I were to ask you, like, how's your walk with the Lord? And you go, well, man, like, I read my Bible, I pray, if I was feeling like really flush today, so I put a fiver in the plate over there, and I'm good. I'm good. I'm doing everything God told me to do. Peter says, well, listen up, guys, gals. Speaking mostly of the men here, okay? He says, listen up. You guys, because you were wrong about Jesus, put him to death. And so this morning, if you think you're okay, guess who else you're wrong about? Yourself. This is a powerful thing that's going on. See, because to actually get right with God, You have to be right about Jesus, like who he is, and you have to be right about yourself, that you are like a felon, that you are a criminal in God's eyes in desperate need of a Savior. And if you don't have that desperate need of a Savior, then the interest in Jesus is greatly diminished, isn't it? Because if I don't need a Savior, I mean, he's a nice teacher, he's a nice guy, I know some Christians are nice people, but, you know, I got other stuff to do this morning. And so he's of no interest, and so you condemn him, having acquitted yourself. Now, clearly the Spirit and the Word's been at work, because they ask. They ask. They say, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. So something's going on in their heart, isn't it? The interesting thing about the Word of God that is like something that is in the book of Hebrews about that. Chapter 4 and verse 12 of Hebrews says, the Word of God is living and active. Did you know this? Like, this book is alive. The Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. I would offer to you that when Peter speaks, he's taking a two-edged sword, and he's wielding it. In that text on spiritual warfare, the one of offensive weapon, you know, besides shields and breastplates and so forth, is the sword of the Spirit, which is the uttered word of God. The Greek word there is for the spoken word of God. And so he's wielding that sword, and it's a two-edged sword. And you know how the sword cuts? It's a two-edged sword. It cuts two ways. And the first way is to wound, to bring people to a place of understanding their need. And I guess I did that on the four-stroke. Well, guess what the backhand stroke is? It's the word bringing healing. The word wounds us so we know our need, and the word gives us the answer so we are healed. And that's what's going on here. But back to the challenging things. They have been told they're like in trouble, right? And you know, if you're told you're wrong about Jesus, you're wrong about yourself, then you have a choice. They say, what shall we do? They want to be told. But when you ask yourself that, like, what am I going to do? I would offer to you that there are two popular answers. One is about a river in Egypt. Denial. Which is, nah, Jesus isn't really like the Son of God. You know what? And the stuff that I'm participating in that would God disapprove of, nah, come on, everybody's doing it. Times are changing. I'm not so bad. I stopped beating my wife like 2 weeks ago. I'm good. I mean, exaggerating. You know, people who are living good lives think they're okay. And that's the whole denial thing. By the way, if you walk your life in denial about Jesus and about yourself, it is a walk that always is like downhill. It's down the escalator, it's down the staircase, and it always ends in death, and after that, eternal punishment. So when the sword wounds, it is not to hurt you. It's to get you to receive the good news that you're wrong. What? It's to get you to receive the good news that you are wrong about Jesus and about yourself. Because when you get that right, then the promise flows. What shall we do, they ask. Peter gives a primary answer. It's a simple word. It's a Bible word. Repent, right? Yeah, that's what the guy in the street in New York that is like dirty and unshaven, and he's got that sign, right? Repent, right? For the end is near. Yeah, right? And we can kind of dismiss that word. The word repent shows up in the Old Testament and the New. And the Old Testament, the Hebrew word for repent, I'll pronounce it for you probably poorly, but it's the word shuv. And what shuv means is if I'm walking this way, and I decide, I don't decide, but my behavior is, I turn around. Yeah, when we were in the Navy, you did that. They call it like reverse march. So I'm marching this way, and they say reverse march, so I pivot on my right, ball of my foot, and turn around and go the other way. It's like a behavioral change. Like you're being a bad kid, quit it. My parents had an expression, Mikey, it's time to fly right. It's time to get it right. So quit that. Okay, Mom. It's interesting because this is the New Testament, and it was written in Greek. The Greek word has a different meaning than like that turnaround meaning. It is a compound word, and the two words are change and mind. Change your mind. That's different than changing your behavior. Has anybody here ever been or ever dealt with, what was it James Dobson called? A strong-willed child. Okay? And formerly known as stubborn knucklehead. There are people here with their kids going, it's not just... Ever dealt with that? Okay, that's the kid where when you put him in the timeout chair. We actually had one kid that an adult had to sit on to keep him on the timeout chair. You put them in the timeout chair, and what's going on is they're in the chair, and they're two for granted, and what's going on in their mind and their heart is, I'm sitting down on the outside, but on the inside, I'm still standing up. You can hear God command you to repent in that Old Testament Hebrew language sense. And what you're hearing is your dad saying, Mikey, fly right. Straighten up and fly right is the full expression. And so you'll change your behavior. But the word that's here in the Greek is to change your mind and your heart, not just your behavior. And that's a whole different proposition, isn't it? To basically decide, like, I don't like this sin, and I want something better, and then a willingness to turn away from that sin to discover that there's something better is right there with you, and his name is Jesus. It's a different idea. And what typically has to change in your heart has everything to do with a five-letter word that is actually at the heart and the root and the seed of sin in your life and mine. And oh, by the way, Eve's and Adam's. You remember, you know, Adam and Eve, like they're in the garden, it's all good, right? And then the serpent shows up. And comes to Eve and says, hey, what about that, like that tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that fruit, that looks appealing, doesn't it? And she says, well, we're told, you know, we'd die, not even going to touch it. And say, oh, come on. God didn't surely say you will die. Because if you eat of it, you will know good from evil, and you will be like God. Basically offers her the opportunity to decide that God isn't who he says he is from an integrity standpoint, and she is better than she is from a personal pride standpoint, and step out from underneath the protective umbrella of obedience to God. And that move, and her husband who was with her, Adam, ruined this place for all of us. What was it rooted in? Pride. So when you're told by the Word of God and the Spirit of God that you're wrong about Jesus, and you go, I'm not wrong about Jesus, I know exactly who he is and he's not for me, that is pride. Did you know that God's Word says repetitively, Old Testament, New Testament, God opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble? I think even the most kind of irreligious people, when you talk about God, do kind of have a sense that God is like, you know, powerful. And like real big and stuff? Does it seem like a smart idea to pick a fight with God?
No.
Thank you. It's not a good idea to pick a fight with God. He opposes the proud and gives grace to the humble. And so when you're walking in pride saying, you know what? I'm not going to buy what the Word of God says about me being like broken and in need of a Savior. You're like a prideful jerk or like a strong-willed child. You know? Now you may change your behavior because, well, God will approve of me if I do good stuff. No, he won't. He already loves you so much that you don't need to earn his approval. And he paid the price for you to be well on the cross of Calvary. What you have to do is lose your pride and receive the gift he has, which is the gift of new life. And then great changes happen. When we read this text, actually the particular verse here, this verse 38, it's one place in the scriptures where you can be confused. It says, Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You can kind of get the pronouns and the prepositions there sorted in your mind that it says that you have to be baptized to be saved. But that's contrary to every other discussion about salvation in the scriptures. So we know it doesn't say that. See, baptism was a demonstration of your repentance. And repentance leads to forgiveness of sins. When John the Baptist was baptizing people, he baptized Jesus. The deal was that he was preparing the way for the Lord. And in an Old Testament context, he was saying, you got to turn from your sin so that your face in the door Jesus is going to walk through. Because you need to have your sin in the rearview mirror. And so people were doing that. They're saying, yeah, I don't want sin in my life, and I want to be repentant. He said, well, here's what you're going to do. You're going to put your money where your mouth is, and you're going to do an external, like visible, public demonstration of your commitment to not sin. It's kind of like when, you know, any one of us says something like, I'm on a diet, and I had not eaten what's under that sheet right there, the coffee hour stuff. See, if I tell you that, then guess what I got? Look, in this room, I get about like 75 accountability buddies, right? So when you get baptized, you're making a public statement, right, that of a change of life. That was John the Baptist. But when we get baptized in the name of Jesus, it is a public statement that we have turned to him and we belong to him. It's a statement of our identity, and it follows the repentance and the forgiveness. It's putting the fact that we understand we're forgiven on display for the world to see. And how we got there, usually, I mean, if we share testimonies and baptisms, we usually kind of tell a story about, you know, I cracked the code on the fact that I was actually not the victim, but the perpetrator. And then Jesus came and set me free. By the way, baptism, it's in the imperative voice here. It's also in the imperative voice when Jesus speaks of it. Jesus speaks of baptism once, okay? Like commanding us to do it. It's once. It's at the end of Matthew's gospel. And he basically says that as you're going, you need to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. So he says, make disciples of all nations, baptizing who? Them. What's a disciple? A disciple is a committed follower of Jesus. So who scripture says, I'll get baptized here. I'm going to go like all Baptist side this morning. Congregational church. I'm going to go Baptist and say, I believe that the teaching of scripture is plain spoken. That the people that get baptized are people that are doing it out of obedience, having repented. They're doing it out of obedience to God as a demonstration of their new relationship in Jesus. It's one of the ordinances he gives. He gives two. One of them is this table we'll come to in a minute, which is our ongoing celebration of our ongoing participation in the new covenant. And baptism is the initiation of our entry into the new covenant. And so I believe in what I offer to you, that if you are a follower of Jesus and have not been baptized as a believer, you have work to do with the Lord to get right and get baptized. And we'll make that easy. The Sunday after Labor Day, we'll have our church picnic up at the lake. And we will baptize whosoever decides it's time to get baptized. And by the way, I kind of have a low opinion of like you got to wait and be disciple for a decade before you decide. Because what happened here is 3,000 people were kind of got baptized the same day. Boom. They knew nothing. There was no Bible, no Bible study, no New Testament. All they knew was I'd given my life to Jesus and he commanded us to be baptized. And my new life in Jesus is one of obedience, and I'm going to get baptized. Now, look, I got baptized in the Episcopal Church as a governor. Like, they sprinkled me. And then I got dunked. And there's a, Bob calls them dunkers. I think that's from living in Pennsylvania, Dutch territory as a Presbyterian. True? Dunkers, yeah. But I got dunked. Okay, because I was convicted that that's what God tells me to do. And people have asked me, well, does that mean that the infant baptism I had like didn't count? And I would say, well, actually, in terms of at least my understanding of the Word of God, yeah, it didn't count. Because baptism, but by the way, it doesn't count for anything. See, you're saved because of His grace, and you're saved by faith. And it is that faith, by the way, it takes faith to admit that you're wrong when He's telling you are. It means I'm going to stop trusting me and trust Him. That's called faith. It takes faith to accept that Jesus did what He did for you. And quit listening to yourself. It's faith. Faith is another word for trust. I'm going to trust in what God says here. You do that, you're saved. Repentance is the moment I put my faith in Jesus. And everything that follows are activities He calls us to do. And I can tell you the sweep of scripture and personal experience of many, including my own, obedience brings blessing. Now I know there are probably some, I know what they call it. So there are some paedo-baptists in the room that will probably want to have a chat with me later. and we can do that, okay? But I encourage you, be baptized. You're going to be super blessed, okay? It's a great proclamation of who Jesus is in your life. And so that's an act of obedience and demonstrates that you're really his. And then what follows in this description is, along with the package, is your honorable Holy Spirit. That when you repent, you receive, when you come to faith in Jesus, you agree with him. You are the Son of God, and I am a worm in need of your help. When you come to that place, you get the Holy Spirit. And how cool is that? We've talked about the Holy Spirit before. Power for living. Power to be transformed and become like him. The encouragement you need when you're taken to despair. The love that you need when you're feeling unloved. The peace that you need when the world is trying to tell you to be unsettled. All these things are actually right in you by the power and presence of the Holy Spirit. And it's a huge gift. In fact, it's described here. He says, right? Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, verse 38, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. It's not that the sword of the Spirit like wounds the first time. Let me suggest an analogy. Suppose, you start having like some chest pains, and you go to the doctor, maybe they're serious, so you go to the emergency room, and they take some blood samples, they do a little scan and so forth, and they say, you got a problem like with a heart valve. And the only way to fix that is open heart surgery. And so what we're going to ask you to surrender yourself to is a surgical team. It's going to basically like knock you out. Praise the Lord, we live in the time of anesthesia, yeah? Going to knock you out, right? And you're going to slice you right here. Now, I have some friends that have some really cool zippers right here from this procedure. And then I think they probably use a bone saw, so and they're going to slice your sternum, the breastbone here. And they put those retractors on, and I bet it makes a noise like, when they pull your chest open, right? And then they're going to, stop your heart. And they're going to reach in there and slice your heart open. In any other context, what do you call that? A brutal mortal wound, right? And why are they doing that? So a surgeon can go in there and repair a valve, and then sew you up and stitch you up so that, some months later you can show off your zipper and live many years because you've been healed. This is what the Spirit of God does by the sword of the Spirit, is heart surgery. To basically get to a place where you got to go through the thing of, I hate change, I hate change, I hate change. Well, guess what? You get to change. And I hate being wrong, I hate being wrong, I hate being wrong. Well, guess what? You are wrong. And that's like the mortal wound. It hurts. And it's he might bring a healing. The prophet Ezekiel speaks of this. You hear me quote this often. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. I will give you a new heart. And a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. This guy Luke that wrote this was a physician. That just popped into my head. That's what he did for a trade before he became a follower of Jesus and wrote his gospel and wrote this book here. I would offer to you that the challenge for all of us, right, is to let the Lord do the surgery. Submit to him and surrender to him. That if his voice is telling you that there's more to Jesus than you thought, that the thoughts you had were wrong and can be replaced by right thoughts. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He's true. And when you get it right about him, it opens the door to blessings indescribable, unimaginable, to include eternal life. And then you might be wrong about yourself, because if you think you're okay, that's actually the road to hell. And so you've got to get that right, too. And those may be painful messages. They may hurt. But they're being inflicted by a loving God that wants your heart open so he can give you that new heart of flesh that beats for him and give you new and everlasting life. I'll leave you with this one idea, which is that the life that is lived in denial about who Jesus is and about who you are, it's like you're on the down escalator. Maybe you've been in a department store. Thanks to COVID and Amazon, I don't go there anymore much, but maybe you've been in a department store, right, where you're on the down escalator, because you're headed down to that next lower floor, and you see a friend on the up escalator. And if you're like adults, what you do is you holler, say, wait for me up there, and then you ride all the way down to the bottom, and then go to get on the up escalator and go up to the top. But I can tell you what you might do if you're like 13 or 15, right? Which is you might like scramble across like those two like stainless steel things, those ramps that separate the up and the down escalator, to skip the part about getting to the bottom and to get on the up escalator. This is the change that God ordains for your life and mine, is to go from the down escalator to the up escalator. To go from the down escalator to the up escalator. And you know, it's really interesting. I mean, I asked you before, who likes change? And I don't know if I think I saw like somebody say, yeah, like an adventurous kind of person, but everybody's like, I like change. Well, praise God for the change that Jesus brings. Praise God for the fact that if you're on that down escalator, what's at the end is death and then the fires of hell. And when you get on the up escalator, what's at the other end is life and the blessings of heaven. That you go from darkness to light, from death to life. You go from being proud and accursed of God to being humbled and loved and supported and given grace by God. And it's the greatest change imaginable, which requires you to kind of change your mind about this stuff. And with the Spirit of God and the Word of God, He helps you a lot. That's the message that's here. So, anybody want to be in the up escalator? Amen. Anybody like being on the down escalator? No, of course not. See, that's the Word of God, the Spirit of God saying, I don't like that, I want that, boom, that's called repentance. Go for it. Give your life to Jesus if you haven't. And if you have, remember that He is all that He says He is. And that you're not who you'd like to think you are when it comes to sin and unrighteousness. But you put those two together and you swap your sin for His righteousness and know that you are so dearly loved. It's not about pride. It's about knowing you're loved and received by Him. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word this morning. Now I ask, Lord, as we sing, that you prepare our hearts to come to the table, that we might celebrate what you have done for us. In Christ Jesus, in His name I pray. Amen.
Please join us in this familiar hymn as we prepare our hearts for it.
Thank you.
On the night before Jesus went to the cross, he had gathered with his followers in that upper room in Jerusalem for the pilgrim feast that was before Pentecost. It was at that feast that God's chosen people, the Jews, were told. They needed to remember what God had done about 14 and a half centuries earlier when he set them free from captivity in Egypt. Most of you know the story, right, about how he raised up the man Moses and then visited plagues, 10 plagues on the Egyptians. And ultimately, Pharaoh let them go, and then the parting of the Red Sea, the Exodus, and then off on the rather circuitous path to the Promised Land. But the point of the feast was to remember that God delivered you from captivity, that God is a God who delivers those he loves from captivity. And he did it by the power of his right arm, his outstretched hand. And he delivered them free. Signs and wonders and miracles he wrought on the Egyptians that made that happen. Well, Jesus knew that in just a few short hours, by the power of God's right hand, his outstretched arm, that he would set a people free from captivity. Not to the Egyptians, but to sin and to Satan and to death. And he would accomplish that with signs and wonders as Jesus was put to death on the cross. Well, Jesus knew that was happening. And so at that meal, where they had the very special meal and they read the account of the Exodus and God's deliverance, at that Passover meal, Jesus said, "You guys are going to need a new meal because a great act of deliverance, greater than the first, is just about to happen. And so what I want you to do is when you eat the bread, I want you to see that as a symbol of my body and remember me. When you drink the cup, I want you to remember that that cup represents my blood, which was shed for you, and I poured out my very life for you." The life was in the blood, was the cultural belief at the time. Profound thing Jesus was going to do. It's that act of deliverance that is why we're here today. Because by his blood we are set free. By his death our sins are forgiven. By his willingness to do that, we see God's love and Jesus' love. We see his mercy and his grace, and we receive all that we need without doing anything but trusting him. Isn't that wonderful? Praise God, that's what he did. But he told us to remember it. He also told us in his word in the New Testament that describes what we're about to do, which is to have the bread and have the cup, that we need to examine ourselves. And if you think about it, if all of your sins were on a cross 2,000 years ago, and we are celebrating the fact that all of our sins are forgiven, why on earth would you have, you know, some sins clutched in your fist right now, or in your pocket, or in a shoebox on the closet shelf? And so we're called to examine ourselves and confess any sin that we have, that we might together celebrate that he took it all. And I would offer to you that if you haven't, like, given your sins to Jesus yet, you can basically back up the whole dump truck load of your sins right now and give it to Jesus. And he will take it all. And you will be completely clean and forgiven in God's sight. And so this can be a very powerful moment as we give him a little bit of sin and remind him that we, you know, haven't given the rest earlier. Or he can give it all in these minutes ahead. And actually the moment ahead, because we're going to do that right now. So let's all just have a quiet moment here, and with his help, examine yourself. And if there's something you need to give to him to confirm that it's really on that cross, let's do that right now, shall we? Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds, we are healed.
gather to celebrate and remember your death, a perfect sacrifice for us. Lord, we ask that you bless this bread as a symbol of your body broken for us, as that sacrifice that paid for our sins. We accept you. We just thank you for this, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." As you receive your bread, I invite you to hold it that we might eat together as a symbol of our unity in the body of Christ. Hear these words of Jesus. "Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life." Let's eat together. You know that you are ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. Roger, we give thanks for the cup, please.
Lord Jesus, before you were captured,
betrayed, crucified, you should pray this prayer to God. Take this cup from me, if it is your will, but not your will, but mine, or not my will, but yours, Father. And so you faithfully, obediently died for our sins. This cup we are partaking represents the blood spilled for us, the blood you spilled for our salvation, for our forgiveness, that we may be ever with you. And we just praise you and thank you for the cup. I ask your blessing on it now. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. For I received from, in the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. As you receive the cup, I invite you to think of it this way. Jesus died for you. He died for your sins. He shed his blood for you. It is intensely personal. I've made this speculation before, but it does make sense that his love for you is sufficient that if you were the only one among the human race that had fallen into sin, he would have come and died for you. So powerful, so personal. So while we do drink this as a family right now, you don't need to wait for the rest of us. Drink it with your Savior as you enjoy his presence and express your gratitude to him for what he did. word of God says, as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. We celebrate his death because in it he bought our new life, our freedom, our deliverance, our forgiveness. But he didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He rose from the dead. Christ is risen.
He is risen.
Amen. He is. He ascended into heaven and he's promised to come back, perhaps even today. Oh, come, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father, for the blessings, the abundance of new life in Christ. We thank you for celebrating this hour. Lord, as we've had this banquet, I know it was just a morsel and a sip, but it is a banquet that reminds us of your incredible, astonishing, amazing love for us, and the fact that we were bought with a price and we're not our own, and we have the privilege of serving you, the living God, for the rest of our time in this flesh until that day you come back or you call us home. And so, Lord, just fill us with your love. Fill us with your grace. Fill us with your spirit. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Well, amen. Let's close our time of worship this morning together by singing this last song. Please join us.
Joy of the Father.
Lord, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and in life forevermore. And we all came together as we said in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thanks for being with us this morning. Be blessed.
All right. Okay.